what's happening here. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
All right, good. You know, ladies, I was initially asked to do a solo for this luncheon, and Cynthia and I were talking, and I said, "You do?" I said, "Who told you that I would even sing?" And a little birdie who used to go to church with me knew that. But this song means a lot to me because it's all about prayer. And I think that's been the theme of today. Don't you agree?
Yes.
It's been a lot of wonderful prayer. And without it, I really couldn't sustain myself. If I go a moment without praying about something, I can pretty much assure you I'm going to do the wrong thing. So sometimes I have to say, "Jesus, take the wheel." So with that, I'd like to share a song with you. And please bear with me. I'm dealing with sinus issues. Who isn't? We're in North Texas, right? When I feel the best of me is ready to begin, then there are days when I feel I'm letting go and I'm soaring on the wind. 'Cause I've learned in laughter or in pain how to survive. When I'm on my knees, I can be in a crowd or by myself or almost anywhere when I feel there's a need to talk with God.
Awesome.
awesome job. Thank you so much, my sister. And something really does special happen when we're on our knees. I am Shaniqua Bailey Cager, and I am the proud baby sister of the speaker for today. And I am just super excited to have the opportunity to introduce her on today. Thank you, President Mickens, for this opportunity. And so I didn't know where to start. I was like, should I tell you guys about our favorite pastime as children? Or maybe I should talk about how when we remember moving into a new home when we were 6 and 8, and we thought it was an amazing play area, only later to find out my parents were like, no, we just didn't have furniture and it just looked like a big room. And so we would flip, and I was doing gymnastics and she was doing dance. And we thought we had struck it rich, but then when they filled it with furniture, we were like, oh, so we're just average. Okay, great. And so I was like, well, maybe I should tell you about when we went to middle school together. And my sister has always been amazing in the English department. And so she had this amazing English teacher. And then they bumped her up to English 1 and pre-AP, only for baby sister to come along. And I was like, yeah, I'm not that good. Put me back in the regular class. Or maybe it was when we both went to Carter High School and she won Miss Carter. And I watched God transform a shy girl that we grew up together with. And she stood on the stage and she began to sing one of my favorite songs by Jennifer Holliday in the musical Dream Girls. And she began to sing Change and how God takes this butterfly first as a caterpillar, and then you watch it go through the metamorphosis and the cocoon, only for it to emerge what we thought was just a regular old fuzzy worm into a beautiful, colorful butterfly. And she stood on the stage in high school, and it was there that I realized that God was doing something amazing in her life. I saw a young girl when we were in elementary school who would not open her mouth and talk to people. When we got to middle school, some people said that they were going to jump on her, and her baby sister showed up like, what was that? I couldn't hear you. Say it again. I've been the defender of her most of our lives. But there on the stage of Carter High School, God began to change her, and God began to take her through this beautiful metamorphosis. She graduated from Carter and went on to Fisk University. And there, we all cried at her doorstep because she was the first child to go away from college. And my father cried so long that my mom was like, somebody's got to drive us back to Texas. I need you to get us here. She graduated from Fisk University, went on to Beeson Divinity School, kicking and screaming. And I watched God as he took her through this metamorphosis of change, of how if you submit your life to me, I promise what I give you in exchange will be more than what you could ask, think, or even imagine. And so I'm grateful today because what we believe in faith, God allowed my eyes to see him walk my big sister through it. And so each day I just continue to try to walk in her footsteps. And she's one of the best preachers I know. Mm-hmm. But more importantly, she's one of the best women I know. Mm-hmm. Whatever she does it with passion. She does it with purpose. And she does it without interrupting the peace that God has given her. I want to introduce to some of you and present to some others my favorite sister, Cokiesha Bailey Robinson. Praise the Lord. Amen. This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and do what?
Be glad in it.
I don't know about you, but it's a great day to be glad, isn't it? I am so thankful for this opportunity because preachers and speakers and Bible teachers, we never stand before audiences because we are prepared enough. We're thankful for solid theological educations, but we don't stand because of our bio and the schools we've gone through. We don't even stand because our parents are famous or because of our pedigree. We stand because of twins called Grace and Mercy. Amen. Anybody grateful for Grace?
Yes.
I thank the Lord for Grace. I'm at a loss of words right now for many reasons. One, because I love December. I love Advent season, the season that we long for Jesus Christ, the season that we celebrate his birth, and the season that serves as an arrow that points to springtime when we will celebrate his resurrection. Amen. My mentor, Reverend Dr. Robert Smith, Jr., preaching professor of Beeson Divinity School in Birmingham, says, the cross and the manger are made from the same wood. And that's why I'm excited about December. I'm not only excited about December because of Advent and Christmas, I'm excited about December because I was married on December the 16th. I thank the Lord for Reverend Timothy Robinson, who I will talk about in my story today. I honor God for him. He is the pastor of my home and heart. And I also thank the Lord that on Sunday we'll be married 11 years. Yes. And so I give God praise for the opportunity to be a preacher and a preacher's wife. Both things I ran from but couldn't escape. I'm also thankful because December 19th is my dad's birthday. And wherever I am, I stand on his shoulders. He's with Jesus, but he's present even when he's absent. I thank the Lord for godly parents. Not only my dad, my first pastor, but his wife, my mommy, and the woman that I want to be when I grow up is present. Allow me to thank God for my Shiro and my first teacher, Dr. Sheila Bailey. I love you. When my dad was close to the end of his life, I said, Daddy, oh my gosh. In our family, my mom, my sister, and my brothers, they were a crew. Anybody have a crew in the family? My dad and I, we were our own crew. And I said, Daddy, I really don't want you to leave because you're my very best friend. But if you leave, also in the spirit of keeping it real, nobody else in the family is dark-skinned and chubby. So I'm going to be the odd one out. I love the fact that we look just alike. We have similar personalities. We have the same birthmark. He was my hero, still is. And he said, Keisha, if I pass away, you and your mother are going to discover you have way more in common than you know. Amen. And 15 years post his death on earth and a better life in heaven, I am so thankful that my mother and I see so many things in her that I see in myself. And I want to just personally thank the Lord for a mother that taught me the Bible and that teaches me Christian servitude. Amen. Amen. Whoever I am and am becoming, it's because it's a reflection of you. Let me thank the Lord for Reverend Dr. Cynthia Mickens Ross. Can we give it up for our leader? An extraordinary leader and an even better friend. I thank the Lord for big sisters. I've reached middle age this year. Praise the Lord. I wish we could have been born at 40 or 45, but we have more sense. But it feels good to be 45. But even big sisters need big sisters. And although I've entered a season of life where some circles have considered me a trailblazer amongst women, trailblazers need trailblazers. Many of them are here. So let me honor pastors and women in ministry that have gone before me. I stand on your shoulders and I honor you and I thank you. A few weeks ago, my husband had a car accident and I was in a place where I felt like Calgon, take me away. You ever been there? And Sister Cynthia, Dr. Cynthia sent me a text that said, what do you need beyond prayer? I needed somebody to ask me that. I appreciated Facebook posts that said I'm praying for you, and I needed prayer. But I needed someone to say, perhaps the preacher needs something other than prayer. And I want to tell you, for that reason and many more, I want to be like you when I grow up. I know it's not easy being the leader that you are. You stand on amazing shoulders. Many women that I've admired so many years. But I want to thank the Lord. It's your season. And I know that nothing will stop God's hand, marvelous hand and plans for your life. Thank you for doors that you're opening for each of us. I want to get to the story. My personality is to go table to table telling people that are here what you mean to me, but I'll need to be forgiven for that so I can jump into the story. But can my friends and family wave your hand? I see another mentor. Thank you so much. Delta Sigma Theta is represented. So many friends from ministry. I thank you from my heart for joining us today. I was asked to tell a story. So I'm going to do something that's very new to me because I'm a preacher, but I'm not going to give you a text. I pray that some footprints from my life journey, good and bad, will give you an opportunity to see God's grace. Amen?
Amen. Dear Lord, this is your story. It does not belong to you. I am yours, and I give myself away. And I pray that you will receive this story unto yourself and bless every leader, mother, woman that is present. Thank you that there are no big eyes and little U's in the kingdom. Thank you for my story. I give it back to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Good to see you, Jen. Thank you and Genesis Foundation for your friendship. This is my story. This is my song. We all have a story, don't we?
Yes.
Thank you, Heather, for your leadership and assistance today. Well, I guess my story can be chronicled. In fact, I don't have time to tell you the whole story. You may have to meet me at the house, Papa Do's, or Starbucks. But for what time? Well, we have time. I have an opportunity to give you some glimpses of my story. It could probably be summarized as this. A woman who arrived early and bloomed late. Anybody been there? A woman that arrived early and bloomed late. What do you mean, Cokiesha, that you arrived early? I'm glad you asked such great questions. It was July 4th, 1973. My mother played an awesome game of volleyball in the backyard with her husband, Pastor E.K. Bailey, Pastor Ross Cullins, and other friends of the family. Good barbecue, good volleyball game. You can't get better than that. How does that day end? You guessed it. Sheila Bailey was rushed to the hospital, 7 months pregnant. Backseat of my father's Monte Carlo. I took my first breath. And you won't believe it, but my birth certificate says, born July 5th, 1973, Presbyterian Hospital, parentheses, parking lot. For many years, I mumbled under my breath, now, seriously, did they have to give me the parking lot parentheses? But now I've come to thank God that He sovereignly ordained my surprise entrance several months early in the backseat of a Monte Carlo. Unexpected beginnings. Where are you in life? Is it an unexpected beginning? What backseat experience are you taking your fresh new breath? So I want you to know that it's already been planned and purposed by the Prince of Peace. I thank God for those first breaths and that He extended my life. I came in as a bouncing baby girl at 4 pounds. I'm thankful that God has a plan for premature babies. Thank God for grace. Well, the story moves pretty quickly. I was born into a pastor's family. I couldn't undo that. Born into a household of a powerful man and a powerful woman, perfectly imperfect, that would lead one of the fastest growing African American churches in Dallas, Texas in the 70s and 80s. I saw God use my parents, bless my parents, not only in Dallas, but around the world. And I secretly said to God, I love how you're using my parents, but please, whatever you do, don't call me to do that. Anybody ever been there?
Yeah.
So I remember growing up, seeing my dad say, put on your robe and comb your hair and wash your face and brush your teeth, and all of you, A.B., Shaniqua, Imani, Cokiesha, meet us at the kitchen table. Niqua, do you remember? I can still hear my dad in my sanctified imagination slurping on his Cheerios, slurping on Frosted Flakes or Corn Flakes with strawberries and bananas, sipping coffee, and then he would lead us through our daily bread or other devotionals, a scripture and a prayer. And one day I remember saying, Daddy, how long do we have to do devotions? I mean, we meet at this table Monday through Friday. Do we ever get a break? Why are we doing this anyway? And he said, because one day I won't be here. One day your mom won't be here. But I want kids that know Jesus. And it's not enough for your daddy to be the pastor. You have to know him for yourself. And we sit at this table so that you all can learn how to pray. You all can learn to speak with Jesus. And you all can learn how to lead. Speaking of, you all are getting ready to start doing the prayer. And so I remember I was so shy and so insecure and so introverted as a child. And I remember my dad saying, today Cokiesha's going to lead us. And I thought, kick it to Niqua, she's not shy. He said, no, I said you. And I remember saying, I don't know what to say. And he said, close your eyes. You're not talking to us, you're talking to God. He said, just talk to him. so I started thinking about what Deacon said at church. I said, Lord, I want to thank you for keeping me in the palm of your hand. I want to thank you for this meal. Keeping my mother while she cooks this meal, keep her in the palm of your hand. And thank you for Nikwa, and keep her in the palm of your hand. And my brothers, Iman and AB, keep them in the palm of your hand. Daddy said, amen, amen. Cokiesha, you know God can do more than keep you in the palm of his hand. My daddy was teaching me that prayer is a two-way street. It's not just a monologue, it's a dialogue. I talk to God, he talks back to me, but I also need to expand my view of God to see that he can do more than keep you in the palm of his hand. And I thank God that growing up gave me a chance to do just that. When I was a kid, I used to look in the African-American context. You often see us clapping and dancing, and sometimes we take out running, and I know it scares some people to death. But the thing is, when we look back over our life, and you don't have to be black to emote. D.K. Bailey used to say, sometimes when you think, you ought to think. Thinking what God has done in ages past produces present day faithfulness. Yeah. And so as a kid, I hadn't been through anything. So I used to look at people shouting in church and say, now that's just a little too much. I was a conservative praiser as a kid. Then I grew up and started admiring people that did it, but I didn't have the courage, and I didn't want someone to think that a kid was making fun. So I just would maybe raise my hand, but I hadn't gone through anything. But the story continues. It quickly continues because as a child, I saw God saying, you are comfortable being in the back seat of this family, but I'm going to prepare you for a front seat. And even if you have to look up to your baby sister who has more personality and is more extroverted than you are, this is the season where your little sister may be beating up the people at school that's picking on you, but you're going to have your own voice one day too. And I was secretly jealous of my sister, because how could I be the big sister but didn't have the courage to have my own voice? And so I thank the Lord for my sister that God used as my big sister before I got the nerve. I remember being so shy. I don't know if anybody is there. How can God call a public speaker as a shy person because we don't tell him what to do? And he changes our personalities to accomplish his will for our lives. You all, I was so shy. I remember being overwhelmed every Sunday we pulled up to Concord Church. In fact, I already knew as soon as we pulled up, people would get excited to see the pastor's car. They would open the door. Good morning, Pastor. Good morning, Sister Bailey. Shaniqua, Cokiesha, Iman, AB. And that alone would take my breath away before I stepped out the car. So I started practicing on Saturday night. Pastor Renee, I would look in the mirror and say, good morning. How are you? And I would say back to myself, I'm great. How are you? And yourself? I want to encourage someone that God has shown your future and you feel like, I don't have the personality for that. God has a way of helping you practice for your purpose.
Yeah, now.
When my husband and I were married, and I'll get to us in a few minutes, I remember Dr. Smith and Pastor Carter marrying us, and Dr. Smith said, today, Keisha and Tim, you call each other baby and boo. But one day you're going to want to call each other something else. He said marriage is about living out God's will for your life until your feelings catch up with you. Mm. I'll be married 11 years this week. I know what he's talking about now. But in those days, I had to express myself as a daughter in a prominent pastor's family before my personality could catch up with my purpose. I thank God for amazing grace. Concordians kept hugging us and loving us and allowing us to be different. And they provided an extraordinary life and lifestyle for my family. But most of all, they exposed me to the best preachers in the country before I got to seminary. And everything I know about Jesus is because of my parents and my Sunday school teachers. I give God praise for the local church. I know how to pray because individuals from Concord mirrored that for me and my family. But I have to tell you, on behalf of preachers' kids all over the world, we don't have it all together. Sometimes I was frustrated by the pressures of people thinking the pastor's family should know all the answers in Sunday school. The pressure of being out dating and seeing people look over their eyes like, who is this they're dating? And do we approve? sometimes people feel like you could have worn a different color, you could have worn a different dress, maybe you could lose a little weight, maybe you should be more like your sister, maybe am I the only one that remembers going through the comparison game? Sometimes feeling inadequate and not enough, like others were better than I was. Or sometimes, as happy as we were as a family, people projecting their own opinions that they developed of you from looking at your family from afar. I remember some people feeling like, I have to humble her because if she's in that family, she must be arrogant. So I'll do this to make sure she doesn't think she's all that. I wanted to know what it was like to be in an ordinary family. In a family where people didn't respect your dad's preaching or respect your mother as an awesome Bible teacher, but I couldn't unscramble the egg. I could trust God to give me what I needed to persevere. And I didn't know as a kid that God was making me a strong kid so I can become a strong woman.
Yeah.
As a kid, I remember we were dropped off at the babysitter's, and we loved the babysitter so much, but unbeknownst to my parents, she smoked. And she put her cigarette in the ashtray and walked out the room. And her child didn't know what he was doing. He picked up the cigarette and put it in my head. My head caught on fire. Many degree burns. I still have proof of the burns in the back of my head. My dad told the story that embarrassed me many years ago. But now at 45, I no longer get embarrassed because I see God's hand.
Amen.
I have ugly prints that are in my head of burned scalp, but I am a living testimony.
Yes.
I thank the Lord that I was burned, but I was not destroyed.
Yes.
And there's someone here that has an ugly scar that nobody knows about.
Yes.
It's just a reminder that God's footprint says, I was here.
Yes.
And so I thank the Lord for ugly stories that help us become who we are becoming.
Yes.
So I remember growing up, dealing with burns in the back, being chubby, having weight that went up and down, up and down. Anybody ever have weight that goes up and down, up and down? Just wondering, can God use a chubby little preacher's kid, the most insecure one in the family? What could he call me to do? And then I discovered God wanted me to be a writer. I'm so thankful for writers, and I celebrate you. I wanted to be a writer that stayed in the background. I wanted a voice without being in the public. And so a professor, a teacher at Carter High School, and somebody has thought your whole life, can any good thing come out of Oak Cliff, Texas? I'm sorry if all you know about Oak Cliff is drama. Can any good thing come out of Oak Cliff, Texas? Certainly. Because being Miss Carter High School to me is better than being a preacher, better than being a speaker. It's a badge of honor because I know where I'm from and I'm proud of it. I thank the Lord for his grace at Concord in Oak Cliff, Texas, Carter High School in Oak Cliff, Texas. And I still remember preparing to go to Fisk University. And my dad said, what's the last thing you want to do before you go to college? And I said, well, I want to run for Miss Carter. And he said, well, you have to keep your grades up. And I said, okay. I got my formal dress. I practiced my song. Daddy said, I have to tell you, I won't be able to come because I have a revival. And I said, Daddy, Miss Carter's a big thing. And he said, but for us to live in this house, I have to have a job. And revivals, they are my job. And so he said, your mom is going to be there. And I said, I know I want mama there, but I want you there. And he said, I'm going to be praying, and I love you. And as God would have it, thanks be to him, they announced the winners, Mr. Lullinger Washington, Miss Cokiesha Bailey. And one of my favorite stories in my lifetime is my dad saying, that's my girl, that's my girl. And I remember saying, Daddy? I said, I thought you had revival. And he said, you were more important.
Oh.
So when I think about the things that I need to tell this audience, thank you so much. I need to tell you it's important to come from a home where they can push you, where they can push you to see who you are and who you are becoming.
Yes.
It's important to have family that can say, I had this engagement, but it was breakable because you are more important.
Yes. Yes.
I'm so thankful that Fisk University allowed me to be accepted, and thanks to Dallas Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta, I won a scholarship later became a Delta, later acknowledged my call into ministry. Came to Concord Church and worked on the pastoral teams and the administrative teams, and God used radio to launch me into ministry. I wish I had more time to talk about how working as a church secretary gave me a chance to be open to becoming a preacher of the gospel. How are you called to preach in a church where women cannot preach the gospel?
All right, all right.
That's a whole nother conference.
That's right.
But I thank the Lord that He's sovereign.
Yes.
He knew that I would have an early arrival and late bloom.
Yeah.
But I want you to be reminded that even when you bloom late, you're still blooming.
All right now.
I want you to know, even though you had a surprise beginning, you are becoming. And I'm thankful today that Concord changed their position on women preachers.
Amen.
And many years ago, when I cried, God, don't make me a preacher. Daddy will never go for this. God, don't make me a preacher. Nika was outspoken. Why would you choose me? God said, I laid my hands on you, and all you got to do is say yes and open up your mouth.
Yeah.
And I went through silent suffering for many years, not wanting to betray my own theology. You ever been there? Not wanting to betray my dad. Silently planning to go to seminary so nobody would know that I was a new boat rocker. And it was on a day as I closed that my dad stood up before Concord Church and said, I am sick and I may not live longer, but I gotta acknowledge my daughter is a preacher.
Ooh.
And I don't wanna be the reason that she doesn't walk in her purpose.
Wow.
And from this moment on, women will be welcome to preach the gospel.
Yeah.
And I gotta tell you, thanks be to God, all the loneliness, all the frustration, all the questions, question marks turned into exclamation marks.
Yeah.
And if you are in that place, I want you to know that waiting is a ministry.
Mm-hmm.
Don't go ahead of God. He changes people, personalities, and paradigms.
Yeah.
And just at the end of that month in 2003, I went from being a woman in silent suffering, a broken heart from a broken engagement, to being a woman living joyfully at Beeson Divinity School. And it was at Beeson Divinity School that I learned that I had attention deficit disorder. It was at Beeson Divinity School that I got on medications for illness that I didn't even know I had. It was at Beeson Divinity School that I went through depression because I had a new experience to learn to live without my daddy. But it was also at Beeson Divinity School that I wrote several books by the grace of God. It was at Beeson that I learned how to speak Greek and Hebrew. It was at Beeson that I sat next to a man named Reverend Timothy Mark Rogers. And on our graduation weekend, we did more than get a Master of Divinity. I got an MRS degree too. I'm so glad that he put a ring on it. But most of all, I'm thankful that I learned who I am and who I was. Marriage is awesome, but marriage doesn't make me somebody. I am somebody in Jesus Christ. And if I were still single, I'd be the woman that God called me to be. Whatever you are, whoever you are, rock your black girl magic. Rock your white girl magic. Rock your short hair. Rock your long hair. Rock your season. Why? Because you have a story to tell, and our story is wrapped up in His story.
Yeah.
Who cares that I went to Beeson? Who cares that I'll get a doctorate from Baylor? Who cares that I'm married? I don't care. What I care about is the one who's given me grace, amazing grace.
Yeah.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. I once had low self-esteem, but now I'm found. I once had no idea what I was called to be. But as you can tell, all of that has changed. This is my story. This is my song. Praising my sake all the day.